Hi, so welcome to another edition of The Big Fat White Guy. And for today, we're going to talk about legacy recipes. Legacy recipes are those recipes made by people who we know, probably an aunt, a grandmother usually, even a great-grandmother, who used to cook for the family, and they have recipes that are only known to them. They prepare foods to say a certain way despite the fact that it could be a common food. In any case, this legacy recipe is from my aunt, the elder sister of my mother. Her name is Ensuida Siy Go. She was born in the 1920s and she used to live also in the family compound. In those days, they have family compounds in Manila where the big mansion, the big house is actually bought by the eldest patriarch of the family. In this case, it was my great-grandfather, Siy Go, who was born in the late 1800s and died in 1937. Anyway, the grandchildren, of which my mom and her sisters and her brothers were living there in the 1950s, 1960s, and this aunt of mine is the one who cooks for the family. I guess she was the sous chef when my grandmother, the major cook, was doing all the cooking. So one of the things that she used to do is this dish called adobo pusit, okay? So which means that it's again another adobo dish, but you don't use a chicken nor pork. What you use here is squid. Now, she prepares it in a certain way that what she emphasizes more is the brininess of the squid rather than the vinegars and the pepper or the other spices, because what you do not want to do here is to get away from the real flavor of the squid. And my brother, who's now in his late 50s, he's 8 years older than I am, used to live in this compound when he was a small kid. And one of the things that he said to me was that if you can just recreate that squid recipe, I would be very happy. So I was thinking in my mind, what could it actually be? Because I, of course, happened to taste it when I was a kid as well. And one of the things that I noticed was that the squid is really totally black, dark in ink, and most likely that is that she gets the squid fresh from the wet market, and this must be the freshest squids. When they got out of the family compound that was located in Dimasalam in Manila, they moved to another part of Metro Manila, and that is Malabon, the home of Rufina Patis. So I guess she must have used also a little bit of patis in there, because I could taste it. I remember that the sensation of that. What the other thing is that there's a school of thought of how you cook squid. Some people say that you only cook squid for a few minutes, then it's done. That's good. That is if you have baby squids, which usually you can buy in Manila. But here in the States, squids come in about this yay size, which are relatively large. You can also buy that large of a squid in Manila. But they can also come this big. And although these squids is also available in Manila, if you do happen to get them, they can be very, very tough. So what she does, even with the small squids though, is that she has a tendency to stew it, really stew, that it comes out tender, well done though, but tender. So it will be reminiscent of the bite of squid that comes from the can, you know, that can that says Ligo and says squid in its own ink. And it's also translated in Spanish, calamar en su tinta. Anyway, I am going to recreate the recipe and see what happens and see if it is good. And I'll see you in the kitchen. The ingredients for adobong pusit in the style of Ensuida Siy Go is very simple. Actually, we only need the following. Of course, what we have here is squid.
Now this is a rather large squid, and actually I would like to have baby squids about 3 finger breadths long, about this big, probably about that thickness. But this one's on sale, and actually this is around 1 1/3 pound. But by the time I clean it, remove all the unnecessary stuff inside, I would probably end up with just like about 1 pound or so. Now I will try to save the ink if I could, if I have it here, but I bought this frozen, and most likely probably the ink is already gone. Well, such is the reason why I have one of these. Now this is squid ink, and you can get that in any internet store, you know, that sells food. So this would come in handy. Now I would explain that adobong pusit in the style of Mrs. Go is actually quite simple. I have seen some recipes that call for a lot of spices, including laurel leaves, like in the style of adobo. Some even put chilies, some even put onions. But the problem with that is I think it masks the flavor of the squid, especially since you wanted to retain the brininess of it all. And also, I must admit that squid ink has its own flavor. Now, in order not to mask those, I choose to be rather very simple with my spices, and that will include the following in this on this plate. And what we have here is just a half a cup of vinegar. Now for my salting agent, rather than use plain salt, I'm going to use patis, which is a derivative of the fermentation of bagoong, which is shrimp sauce and sometimes fish sauce in the Philippines. Now there are two kinds of fish sauces that are prevalent in Asia, but and the more well-known one is the one made in Thailand called nok nam or nok mam, and that is a different process. It is by the salting of fish that you can get the intrinsic liquids, and they still ferment that. That is their basic fish sauce. This one is made of fish, and you add water to that, and you add salt to that, and they leave it to ferment. Now, in the fermentation process of around 6 months to a year or so, you would notice that the solids stay at the bottom of the vat. That is known as bagoong, and on the top of it is the clear amber liquid known as patis. Now that was discovered actually by a housewife in Malabon in the 1900s, and hence the Rufina patis. But they get that liquid and they pasteurize it, they boil it, they pasteurize it, and then they bottle it. So that is what is patis is all about. We have here, of course, your ground black pepper, and lastly, I have like half a clove of garlic. So it's rather very simple, because I wanted to preserve everything, the brininess of the squid, and its intrinsic flavors. So I don't want to put some chilies, I don't want to put the laurel leaves, which will mask it, and all that. And of course I'm dependent on the flavor, intrinsic flavor of the squid, as well as the squid ink. Okay, let's do some preparation. So we have the whole squid right here, and I pulled the head along with the whole body within, and then I cut the head from the rest of the entrails, which are found inside the squid. And also you'll find this thing right here. Of course you discard this. This is the squid bone. So it's going to be relatively a little bit messy, but so you get the body and you slice it open like so, and you will find probably some parts of the entrails of the squid. Therefore you wash this and you set that aside. Now for this entrail, the entrails right inside this bag, I want you to open that and then you wash it underwater, because all this will just destroy the flavor. I don't mind if it's a small squid, but in a large squid like this, this shouldn't go in the dish. Here we have the head, and you have to wash this first before you do anything about it. So I'll come back after this is washed. Okay, so what we have here is the head and the inside of the squid. And I was right, as I opened the thing, you find all the entrails, and the squid's ink sac is already is gone. I mean, there's practically no ink. So you cut this. This you can save. You can eat that. Now, this is the head, like so. And you open it at the underside. These are the two eyes. Okay, eyes. So underneath, you open it this way, and then you will find the mouth. You remove that mouth because that is practically not edible. It's tough, and it's basically like bone. And then you can remove the eyes like that. Also remove the other eye. There. So you can throw that away. And what you're left here with is the squid head and the legs. So that's one, and then right here as well. Now you're left with the body. Now the way to process the body is like this. So first you cut lengthwise with a sharp knife. Okay. Again, lengthwise, and for each of these pieces, you do that. And now, getting each of these underneath, you score them. Lightly score, like you're trying to do a checker box. Like what you do in ham on Christmas Day. You know, when you present ham. 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. I'll do this for the next few pieces, and then we'll get to cooking.
Using a little bit of oil here, we're going to saute the garlic until it's brown. Probably, you know, just a light brown. Not really that toasted, but still, you want the essence of the garlic to come out. Next, add the pepper, so that the pepper's essence could also come out with the sauteing. Once you can smell the pepper and the garlic together, you add the squid. Try always towards the side where some of the heat is well preserved. Once well sauteed, then you add the following ingredients: your patis, your vinegar, and probably like a teaspoon to around a tablespoon of your squid ink. Now this is left to simmer until the sauce is thick. Now, there are some schools of thought on how to prepare squid. Some people would say that, oh, you just have to simmer it for about 5 minutes and you're done. The problem with squid is size, sometimes they can be tough. And some would like to have it a little bit, you know, tenderized by boiling it for how many minutes or so. My aunt does it by boiling for quite some time, that the squid is somewhat very well done but tender. Now that's how my brother likes it. Now I'm not so sure which would work well for this one, so probably after 5 minutes I'll get a half of it and return it back, and the other half I'll just probably have it simmer for a while and see which is much better.
Anyway, now we can cover the thing and let it simmer.
So now we're done cooking adobo, and I have here two dishes of squid adobo. The only difference is that in this dish, I have the squid meat removed about 5 minutes into the cooking, because that's what they say is the most optimum. It's the optimum cooking time for squid, and you don't want it to overcook. So I left some of the meat, however, in the wok to simmer with the sauce. And once I simmer the sauce and the sauce reduces and thickens, I put some of the sauce back in this dish with the squid meat. Meanwhile, I have here the squid that has been simmering with the ink, you know, during the duration of its cooking. So probably I gave it something like 15 minutes or so. And then the leftover sauce in the wok, I put some white rice, steamed white rice, and this is the result. Actually, this is what is known as pamahid. In other words, in Tagalog, it means to wipe. Now, there's a lingering superstition amongst Filipino parents that you do not let your kids eat pamahid, because it means that they'll be eating pahid all most of their life, and that means you're not going to be fortunate. Anyway, that's just a superstition set aside, but I think it's great. I'll have this for din-din later. But now it's time for the taste test and see which I think is the better adobo in terms of the bite. My brother likes the sauce to be very, very thick. In fact, that's how my DE used to prepare it. This is the one that the meat has been removed, you know, it was removed 5 minutes into the cooking. It's good. It has this bite that is reminiscent of the Greek squid salad, or the cold salad of, you know, squid. And it's actually good. It has a nice bite. It's not that tough, and it has very good flavor. It's really good with rice. Now this one right here is the simmered one. It's usually how she prepares it. Now, actually, I might prefer this way because it's going to come out very well done. But on the other hand, it has already been tenderized by the steaming process, and so either way, it's actually good. But the most important thing is that this thing needs to be served with a plate of rice. Anyway, there you have it. So, dinner. And I don't want to show my teeth. Well, it's very good. And you ought to try it. And don't be afraid of the black teeth. You're not going to make a public appearance anyway. But can you just imagine, this is the taste of beluga caviar. And you don't really get black teeth from it, but probably this will be the next best thing. You know, it's going to be costing a fortune, but you know, it's not cosmetically acceptable. So, anyway, I leave you with our discussion on squid adobo, and I hope you try it. And you know, give me some comments if you have some. Visit the blog. It's bigfatwhiteguy.blogspot.com. See you soon. Bye.